as you think about the next few years, call it the next 3 to 5 years, like how do you think and what role do you think AR and VR are going to play in all of our lives?
What I'm really excited about are these. These are our new Ray-Ban stories. And so this is pretty freaking meta right now because I am recording you, recording me, like...
Welcome to Taking Care of Business. I'm Mike Katz, president of the business group at T-Mobile. And today I'm talking to Nada Stirratt, Facebook's vice president of North America. Nada has spent her career at the forefront of the digital content and commerce revolution. Over the past decade, she served as executive vice president of MTV Digital Networks at Viacom, chief revenue officer at both News Corp and Axiom, and then Nada moved into the CEO position at Verve before stepping into her current role, where she oversees relationships with companies of all sizes that advertise on the Facebook platforms. Her team works with small, local businesses looking to grow, as well as the largest global multinationals. Well, Nada, I am so excited to get into this. And I have to ask you first, because I was reading about you and all the things that you do. And I have to give you the short list of extracurricular activities I read about you. You're a pianist, an outdoor enthusiast, a regular on the Peloton leaderboard, an artist, and a dedicated dog walker. What else have we missed here?
I think the most important thing that you missed is on the Peloton leaderboard. I'm actually at the bottom of the Peloton leaderboard, but what you describe is truly a jack of all trades, but master of none. And so I would say the only thing that's missing from that list is reading. I love to read, and I'll talk to anybody about books all day long, every day.
Well, being at the bottom is still, I think, technically on it, which is better than most of us are doing on here. We're not going to embarrass anybody here. There's no question that what you're doing and what Facebook is doing, you guys are on the forefront of innovation on many, many different fronts. But one that I'm really interested in talking with you more about is AR and VR, because you really have taken a leadership position there. And I'd love to get your perspective and thoughts on what are some of the components that you all have used to build this meta universe of AR and VR, and where is it going?
Yeah, this is something that I could talk about for days. It's really, really exciting. So think about the metaverse as this network of interactive 3D worlds, and it's an immersive virtual environment and allows you to be able to share spaces and experiences without geographical barriers that exist today. I made anybody who's of my generation, I made them all go watch Ready Player One and read Snow Crash to really understand how this all comes together. But I think of the three buckets that we look at it, and you have to have all three firing on all cylinders in order to have the experience that you want brands and consumers to have within the metaverse. And so the first one is the actual virtual environment. And so we are doing a ton of work to make VR more robust, more social, creating multiplayer games. You're doing more with fitness and using VR as a work or training device. But there is an opportunity for so much really robust content experiences to be developed in the metaverse. And then the second piece of it is then the messaging, because the metaverse relies on frictionless connectivity in order to work. And so there has to be a way to bridge from one world to the other. And the keystone for Facebook's interoperability vision is messaging. And so that, again, is about connectivity across platforms, across hardware. And then the third bucket is commerce. And so innovating for businesses through things like augmented reality, like people are doing a lot of interesting things on trying on, live shopping through video, or having a virtual shopping experience so that you feel you are really going into a store and have that kind of an experience. And so you need to have these three components right now as we're working to the metaverse. And my favorite stat about the metaverse is that by 2024, Bloomberg estimates that it will be an $800 billion business. And so this is just a sliver of what's possible. And again, there are going to be a lot of people involved and a lot of components that need to be delivered. Things like infrastructure, chips, hardware, graphic engines, apps, and so on and so forth. And so we are going to be relying on many in the industry across the globe to work alongside of us as we build this whole new definition of connectivity. So I'm really excited about it.
I'm excited about it too. And I tell you, like at the cat's house, I've got a couple of my kids who pretty much on a daily basis, I walk in and they've got Oculus goggles on. And so so virtual reality gaming has become like a real thing at our house. And it's fun for them, but it's also fun for me because I can like sneak up on them and they don't see me and I can scare them while they're doing it. So that's like, that's become like one of my favorite pastimes. But you know, as you think about the next few years, call it the next 3 to 5 years, like how do you think, and what role do you think AR and VR are going to play in all of our lives? You know, today certainly it's, you know, kind of gotten a foothold in the gaming space, but like how are we going to interact with AR and VR over the next few years?
Well, even going back to why your kids are using Oculus for games, we've started using Oculus for meetings. And it is pretty remarkable. And even though you're an avatar and the environment is forced, the environment looks like our offices. I got to meet one of our heads of our creative shop, whom I've never met before. And we've been working together now for about 15 months, believe it or not. And there was something very real and tangible to be able to talk as if we're sitting in the same room and looking at the same board together. And so I think the business implications, again, lots of fun, lots of great travel implications that you can have with some of our new hardware. But I think it gets a lot more tangible when you think about how do you do this in the fields of medicine and any kind of working environment. I think it's gonna be pretty big. But what I'm really excited about are these. These are our new Ray-Ban Stories. And so this is pretty freaking meta right now because I am recording me, like, these are our next generation metaverse. And, you know, I would look at this as our next generation hardware, and it's enabled by 5G. And so you can do everything from recording. You can have, I can take pictures. I have really great speakers on this. And there's a lot that we're going to be doing with these. And they just came out and are something that we're incredibly proud of. Just the idea of how we've had to miniaturize everything to get it to work into these kinds of glasses. So I believe that as part of our vision going forward, it's how we can get these kinds of easier, lightweight experiences to many, many more people in many more regions to be able to bring storytelling to a whole new level.
Yeah, I was really excited to read about those, and they look great too. I mean, they look like regular glasses. It's amazing the size that you've been able to engineer them to. It's just really, really incredible. Yeah, you talked about running on 5G. I don't know if you knew this, but we're pretty interested in 5G over here. Can you talk a little bit more about the importance of 5G with a use case like glasses sitting on your face?
Well, I mean, it's everything, right? Because you need to be able to have the right kind of connectivity in order to be able to have that kind of story told, in order for me to transact with you the way that I want to, in order for me to message and to have the shared experiences of content consumption or the shared shopping experiences. All of this, 5G is so vital for all of this to be able to actually even work. So we're really, really bullish on the work that you all are doing.
With over half the planet now connected on mobile devices, what gets you the most excited about this ubiquitous connection that exists across customers? And can you tell me a little bit about what you and Facebook, especially the Facebook Reality Labs, are doing to deepen and expand connections across the world?
So when you say that half the planet is connected on mobile, it also means that almost half the planet is not. And if you back up and think about Facebook's mission, it's to bring the world closer together. And so that relies on having better access to the internet for more people. And connectivity is part of Facebook's 10-year roadmap that remains central to our efforts to bring the world closer together. In 2013, we launched Facebook Connectivity to help expand affordable, reliable, high-speed internet access to underconnected regions, and so far have brought 110 million people online around the world. But obviously, there's a very long way to go. But a little bit closer to home, we recently brought high-speed internet to homes and businesses in Alaska. We're running trenched fiber into these homes and businesses is prohibitively expensive because of the harsh, frozen terrain. And so now many Alaskans have internet speeds close to 100x faster than what they had before. But then if you think about next level, I'm especially excited on how our mission of connectivity is evident in Facebook Reality Labs. And this is the area of our company that's working on really groundbreaking products like Oculus, Facebook Stories, which is our new Ray-Ban glasses, Portal. And FRL creates experiences to help people feel connected, like you're right there with another person and you're sharing the same space, you're sharing the same experiences, regardless of the physical distance.
Well, yeah, I want to ask you a lot more about Facebook Reality Labs, but I want to just ask a follow-up on the work that Facebook is doing to increase connectivity, close the digital divide. First of all, congratulations. Mm-hmm. I mean, those are staggering numbers when you think about, one, you just think about that there's actually that many people unconnected and that you mm-hmm. were able to make yeah. such an impact in offering connections. How important do you think that was, particularly over the course of this last year and a half, both being able to help provide connectivity, but also how much more important do you think the services that Facebook offers became this last year when that actually, you know, in the absence of physical presence, that became, you know, the way that you stayed connected to your community?
Yeah, no question. And looking at consumers and looking at businesses, on the consumer side, it became incredibly vital because we were sheltering in place. Our community on Facebook, on Instagram, our ability to converse and in real time all over the globe with WhatsApp, all of that just became extremely important. And it also was really important for people not only to feel like you're part of the community, but also to be able to have access to the right kind of information, accurate information, finding, you know, we started the COVID Information Center simply so that hundreds of millions of people could have access to where they can get vaccinated. What, you know, we worked with Carnegie Mellon University to be able to create maps to see where COVID spikes were appearing and just truly looked at our role as being a resource to, in this case, a couple billion people around the globe. On the business side, it was very different in that companies had to do a lot of things very quickly. So, for example, businesses who were traditional businesses suddenly had to pivot into the e-commerce sphere faster than they ever thought possible. And I love how you refer to it as the digital divide. And I feel like we've also been talking about, you know, moving on to the web in faster numbers than ever before. And there were still very traditional companies that looked to the web as secondary to their traditional terrestrial business. And we did a lot of work to help people stand up an e-commerce platform and make sure that everything from supply chain management to marketing was working well on this new platform. But I would say the biggest difference and the biggest impact, I believe, has been to small businesses. You're talking about businesses whose entire livelihood may have been based on, I live in New Canaan, Connecticut, so walking down Main Street, I see a small business, I see Wave, where I love to do some shopping. They don't have a robust website. They don't have access to database management and CRM systems, et cetera. And so what we did very, very quickly through a series of small business grants and a host of mentorship opportunities was help them get online to be able to transact and in many cases keep their businesses afloat. So I think the pandemic has been incredibly disruptive on every single level, but I think especially for the small businesses. And so I'm very proud of the work that we all have done, and certainly the work that your company and my company has done in order to help small businesses truly be able to advertise and find new customers during this pandemic.
Have you seen a demonstrable difference, whether it's small businesses or just individuals? Have you seen a demonstrable difference pre-pandemic and then during pandemic, just in the way that they're using all of the Facebook platforms?
So I wouldn't say that it was a difference in how people are using it. People have always come to our services, be it Facebook or Instagram, for connectivity. And so we still saw that. We saw the proliferation of groups. I happen to be in several different interior design groups. And so because I'm at home and I'm staring at these four walls, the group, we were a lot more active than ever before. I also think that people have used things like WhatsApp to extraordinary extraordinary lengths because you've got this really robust video calling platform so that for my family overseas or my mother down in Florida, where it used to be easier to get on a plane to go spend some time with her, it became impossible to do that. And so that was really important. And also to, I am one of her primary caregivers, to get all of her doctors and everybody together to get organized. It was really important to be able to use our platforms for that.
Well, one of the things you mentioned a second ago is the importance, especially for small businesses, in leveraging all the Facebook platforms. And I think you'd probably agree a big part of that is the ability for small businesses to tell their story on this platform and gain new audiences. And I know you are big on storytelling and staying grounded on storytelling. Yeah. Do you think that the fundamentals of storytelling have changed, irrespective of what platform they're on, whether it's, you know, in traditional media, whether it's on social, whether it's now in, you know, multiplayer VR platforms?
Yeah, I think storytelling is more important than ever before. I actually think just because we have this extraordinary technology and lots of bells and whistles, we can never move away from the basics of storytelling, which is to absolutely make sure that you are grounding understanding and an emotional connection in every message that you are making. I think with the proliferation of data and the lots of numbers, we all fall into this rut. And I know you see it every day at work, as do I. I see more charts with more numbers on them. And just because we have the data, we suddenly believe that we're going to get a point across. And I also laugh. I remember being at AOL in the olden days in the 90s and having charts that had all kinds of arrows and clouds and cans. And you've seen them too, because we get so enamored because we know so much information about what's happening in the back, that you fail to make a connection with the audience. And you fail to make a connection, an emotional connection, with any kind of a consumer. And so I believe that especially with small businesses today, and especially with anybody who's conversing with a consumer today, it's about that important connection. Let's not worry about, wow, this is on the mobile device, so let me use different kinds of bells and whistles than I would on desktop or on television. It's about surrounding the consumer with a consistent story that ultimately gets them to think, feel, believe, or do something differently because of that message that you've imparted on them. I think it's incredibly important.
You know, having seen so many storytellers on your platforms, what are some of the examples or you know, a summary of examples of people that are really doing it right and creating impactful, meaningful stories? And maybe you can even contrast that with you know, people that the common mistakes that you see in people storytelling, especially through Facebook properties.
Well, I would say that Instagram launched the entire creator economy. Call them influencers. It's about how do I project what I want you to feel about my brand or my persona to a couple of billion people, in most cases, on a daily basis. So I believe that the work that Instagram has done in order to help creators and help, and whether they are celebrities or people who have become Instagram celebrity because of their followers, that platform itself has done more to storytelling on mobile than any platform I've ever seen before. What I think has been also particularly powerful looking on the Facebook platform is Giving Tuesday. Giving Tuesday was never a thing until a few years ago. Facebook decided that before we get into the frenzy of holiday shopping, let's make sure that we do this for good. And so suddenly to be able to rally an entire platform around donations, around social good, we've delivered 100+ billion dollars to organizations in need. And that is with organizations in need telling a very powerful story on a small screen in a limited amount of space. So making every single word count. And so those are two examples where everything from a commercial brand building to helping me do good in the world all happens because of storytelling across our platforms.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible. Like when you see the people and the brands that have embraced it, how powerful it can be. You know, and I was joking with somebody the other day that I am a Instagram consumer. Like, it does such a great job of storytelling that I have to like convince myself not to actually take action and buy stuff when I'm on Instagram. And it feels like actually the biggest risk for, especially for businesses, is not embracing this versus whether they do it well or don't do it well. It's just not embracing it at all feels like the biggest risk.
Well, and it's like you bring up the best point ever, which is, and you can go in any room anywhere and say to people, raise your hand if you bought something on Instagram that you had no intention of buying before. And it's like, and everybody's hands goes up. And I call that data-based serendipity. And we call it discovery commerce at the company, because that's exactly what the platforms do really, really well. We're never going to be a search engine where you go in and you type in, I want to buy something. It's about creating this incredibly fertile environment. So people like you and me have the most beautiful feed. Like, my Instagram feed is beautiful. I follow the types of businesses and people that really inspire me. And darn it, if every third thing isn't something that I just absolutely have to have because it gets me from my persona. You see that on Instagram, you see that on Facebook, and everybody says the exact same thing that you do.
So I know at the beginning we talked about small businesses and their use of the Facebook platform to reach their customers, and probably this platform may be more important than it's ever been, especially in a world where physical connection with customers is more challenging. You know, we worked together earlier in the year to launch a program in a partnership between Facebook and T-Mobile that offered Facebook and Facebook advertising on us. And I was hoping you could talk a little bit more about that program, you know, the ways that businesses could leverage it and the importance and the impact that you're seeing it have on small business customers.
What made us all so excited about Facebook advertising on us is that it combined the connectivity and the reach of T-Mobile with the strength of Facebook's tools and services. And together, we help the SMBs reach customers and grow their business. And it's not enough to just say, here's what you're going to do, and good luck. I loved what we did together in that we provided mentorship and handholding and advertising credits for them to be able to experience the platform, start to find customers, and most importantly, then be able to do this on their own as their businesses continue to grow. And so it was such a powerful testament to what happens when companies join forces and address important issues like economic empowerment and business growth, especially during times like this. And so we were really excited to partner with you on that.
Yeah, we were too. And I just felt like the timing of it was perfect because, look, we all know that this last year and a half was tough for everybody, but I think particularly for small businesses. And I was so excited that we could put together a partnership that disproportionately benefited small businesses, allowed them to expand their business onto platforms and to customers that, you know, maybe they hadn't tried or tested before. Right. And it's so exciting and encouraging to see the impact that it's having. So thank you. Thank you for your partnership on that. And thank you on behalf of all the small businesses that have taken advantage of it for the support that you're giving to them. If you don't mind, I wanted to shift to everybody's favorite part of taking care of business, which is our rapid fire question. So are you you on board with some rapid fire questions?
Always on board for rapid fire questions.
All right. Well, we talked about your many, many extracurricular activities, but we're going to make you choose a couple here. Hiking or running?
Okay. Hiking.
Okay. So I thought you might say hiking. So what's your favorite hiking spot?
Bryce Canyon. Oh, I love that. It's so beautiful.
Oh, you can't beat Utah. Like, Utah's the greatest, isn't it?
Am I allowed to ask you your rapid fire questions right back at you?
Well, now you're breaking the rules. I don't know what's going on. Yeah, of course you can.
Okay, so are you a hiker or a runner?
If I had to choose between those two, I would say hiker.
Okay, and what's your favorite hiking spot?
I probably would go with Utah as well. I grew up in Western Colorado. I spent a lot of time in Moab. And one of the places that I love, obviously, the big national parks there are awesome with Canyonlands and Arches. But there's a state park there called Dead Horse Point that's like one of my favorite places in Utah. It's just incredible. You can stand up and you can see the Green River Valley and the Colorado River Valley, and they kind of coming together. It's just amazing.
Oh, my God. It sounds heavenly.
How about drawing or painting?
I love to draw.
Okay, so when you're drawing, what's your favorite subject?
So my stuff, usually nature. I love, like, trees are my jam and waterfalls. And so those are the kind of two places I tend to go to most often.
How about fishing, rod or fly fishing?
I would say both, but I would say the biggest dream always is to get to fly fish down in the Florida Keys. It's pretty special.
Everybody's got their favorite fishing story. Like, what's your biggest fish?
No, you can't ask that, especially not on camera, because I'll look like a total tool. I would say the biggest fish I unintentionally caught on a fly was a nurse shark. I was fishing in hoping to get tarpon, and instead ended up with a nurse shark. So that wasn't nothing that you can like take a picture of, but that was very, very big and unintended.
Well, I've noticed when you tell people your fishing stories, everybody automatically discounts whatever you say anyway. So you're fine to...
Exactly.
If you said you caught a great white shark, nobody would have believed it anyway.
Yeah.
Who's your favorite Peloton instructor?
It's a tie between Cody and Jen Sherman, whether I want a lot of energy and dancing or I want just really good music. Those are my two favorites.
Nice. My favorite is the one that tells me that I can stay in bed and eat a lot of carbs.
Yeah. Okay, that would be Cody. I know.
Okay, perfect. Your favorite piano player?
So my favorite piano player today is a very interesting musician named Jordi Fornies. You can find him on Instagram. He's a Spaniard who lives in Singapore, but he's a musician, a composer, a painter, a sculptor, unbelievably talented and truly gifted. And I love nothing more than to be listening to his music and going through Instagram. He's got a beautiful Instagram presence. You should check him out. I think he's one of those new modern day composers to watch, Jordi Fornies.
Yeah, I will. I've noticed with myself that part of my brain is underdeveloped. So I have such a huge respect for people that have the ability to both compose music and create art, because I know myself that I cannot do it. And so it's just absolutely amazing to me when I see people that can do it and do it like almost effortlessly. It's just
effortlessly,
incredible.
Right. Amazing.
I don't want to get you in trouble with this question because it's almost like asking you who your favorite child is, but favorite Facebook product?
So I actually spend equal times on Facebook and Instagram. I've curated Instagram. For Instagram, for me, is more fashion and design, a lot of my celebrity stuff. And then on Facebook, it's my friends, it's my family, and it's also a lot of the different design groups that I've joined. And I kind of feel like every single day, if we don't talk to each other, something's wrong. So I balance both of them pretty easily, actually.
Well, Nada,
what about
thank you?
You
so much.
Wait, I need to ask, I need to ask you first. So tell me, Facebook or Instagram, where can I find you?
For me, I think Instagram. I love Instagram. I'm on both. I love Facebook. My favorite feature of Facebook is the note that I get every single day that shows me pictures from years ago on that day. And love it because, I remember I opened it up this morning, I think 6 or 7 years ago, I was at a football game with my older son and I looked at him. I was like, aww. Oh my gosh, I can't believe that was six or 7 years ago. So I get one of those daily reminders every day, which I love. But I love Instagram, because I just feel like I can kind of quickly scroll through my feed and like understand the people that I care about and a little bit of the world around me in pictures. And it's just like, it's like expressing yourself in pictures and video is like just, it's just different than people writing it on words in Facebook. So I love seeing people's pictures every single day. It's like, it's one of the things I always look forward to is refreshing that feed. Well, I thank you so much for doing this. It was great to get the chance to talk to you, and thank you for everything that you're doing. The commitment that Facebook has in closing the digital divide and bringing connectivity to millions and millions of people is just incredible, and it's never been more important than right now. And then thank you for all of the partnership and the work that we're doing together to help small businesses and offer Facebook advertising credits to help them expand their audience, improve their marketing, and become more successful. And you were a huge part of thinking up and helping us execute that offer. So thank you for everything that you're doing there.
Well, thank you so much. This has been so much fun. I hope we get to do this in person another time. And I just can't thank you enough for being such an extraordinary partner to Facebook, to Instagram. We love T-Mobile. So thank you so much.
Yeah, well, the feelings are mutual. Thank you. I can't wait to, like you said, to do this together. And hopefully we can do that really soon. As a reminder, for each episode of Taking Care of Business this season, we're excited to expand our Project 10 Million donation to a school district of our guest choice, making further progress towards bridging the gap and ensuring that every child in America has equal access to reliable, high-speed connectivity. To our listeners, thanks for joining us, and we'll see you next time on Taking Care of Business.